tulad ng isang ilog na puno ng tubig upang punan ang buong karagatan. Kahit na ang ginagawa na ito ay bumibigay pakinabangan sa mga yumao, ang gutom na espiritu, maaaring ang anumang iyong kahilingan at nanais ay pumasa iyo ng mabilis. Maaaring ang lahat ng iyong mga hinahangad ay matutupad bilang ang buwan sa 15 araw o bilang isang nagliliwanag, maliwanag na perlas. Maaaring lahat ng kabalisaan ay lumayo. Maaaring bawat sakit ay mapuksa. Maaaring mayroong walang panganib para sa iyo. Maaari kang maging masaya at mabuhay ng mahaba. Para sa isa sa kagalang-galang na kalikasan, na patuloy na parangalan ang kapakinabangan. Ang apat na kalidad ay tataas. Mahabang buhay, kagandahan, kaligayahan, at lakas.
When you consider to enter monastic training, become a monk, and train it in the training, what's called the training, you have to begin by 5 rules, you progress to 8 rules, you progress to 10 rules, and then they get more refined, it's 119 rules, and then if you wish to take higher ordination as a monk, then you can do it, like that. But the 5 rules are not to intentionally kill anything knowingly, which breathes. And secondly, not to take anything, steal anything, or take anything which isn't given. And then thirdly, not to involve in any form of cruel sensuality or wrong sensuality, which means adultery, it means paedophilia and rape, such things. And then there's 4 kinds of speech, which is not to lie, not to slander or make false allegation, not to use harsh speech, and not to use nonsense talking, gossip. And then not to use drugs and alcohol for recreation and for unmindfulness. Those are 5. So that's like the regular people. So this is a property that belongs to the Valencia family, Rhodora's family. It's from the 1940s, so it's nearly 70 years old. The upstairs has been empty for a long time since the father of the family died. And just the grandmother who we just saw, she's said we have permission to renovate it and turn it into a welfare office. So the welfare office will be used once it's finished to have computers so locals can come in and learn to fundraise and actually spend the time fundraising. They can also research holistic remedies and also get advice about health, basic layperson's advice about their health. And it can also be used as a library and somewhat as a sort of semi-clinic, you know, that people can report in and show what they're presenting with, their difficulties, and then we can advise, you know, to go in the hospital or whether we can actually help or not. So it's like a holistic center in that sense as well, but also for fundraising and learning how to get their own access to crowdfunding sites like GoFundMe and so on like that.
Yata wariwa hapura paliporenti sahagalang ewa miwa ito dinang petanang ipakapati. Chitan patitan tumham kepamewa samichato sabe purantu sankapa chanto hanara soyata manijo tera soyata sabitio viva chandu sabaro go venasato mate pavatuantu ayo sukidi ga yugo baba abhiwa dana silisa nityam vipa pachayino chataro dhamme vadanti ayuvano sukham.
And then if you wish to sleep in a monastery, you can stay in just like quite regular clothes or like those kind of white pajama clothes looking like that, and then do some duties and help out sweeping and, you know, but live there and eat there and sleep there. Then you have to include 3 more. You keep these, except for the third one goes to like all celibacy, so there's no sexual pleasure, like self-pleasing. Then you refrain from an evening meal. You don't take you reduce the amount that you are eating, basically, and you're more fasting after that afternoon. That you can take liquids, and then you not to use the body for beautification and attraction, so like makeup, cosmetic, hairdo, and you know, fancy stuff to try to make yourself parade like you're looking for attractive,
yeah.
Attracting, exciting other people. And then not to dance, singing, playing music, and that's all included. And that style of like carnivaling, you know, like red light, also that kind of red light district type of like indulging. It goes together with the next one, which is like towards not having a luxury bed, and also then it leads on towards not towards gambling. And it's the style of life, you know, it goes away from that. That's it.
It could be either
So every morning at dawn, I walk around with a bowl, and I entered into the village, and people just didn't know what it was. You know, it's a foreigner, you know, it's a European. They would just look at me or look away, and they just sort of like ask me, "Am I American?" or "Why aren't you wearing any shoes?" was a common one. You know, like why aren't you wearing any shoes? Was a common one, like that. Or many people would think I was a Christian priest, and they would just say, "Good morning, Father," and that's it. And basically, people would more or less be friendly or neutral. And then after a while, like after a month, I think I was doing, or 3 weeks or something, one of my friends here who owns a retreat center, a Filipina, brought her two kids and walked around with me, or would stand on a corner and just explain to people. And in the explaining to people, people started to get it that, oh, right, you know, so he's a monk who's living nearby. He's going to be coming every morning. And what the bowl is something we can put food in, and he will chant a blessing. He can do a blessing. So it sort of started to just catch on like that. Originally there were about four houses which were the staff of the retreat center, and they said always come to ours, and they've still done that since then. And then they've told their neighbors, and the neighbors have now wanted me to come as well. They really respect the blessing. People here really respect that. And more or less what I say before I bless is something like, let's pray. Let us pray together. And mostly what people do now is stand in a sort of circle around me, and then they all just pray together. So it's like a daily exercise like that, where people give it a chance to tune into their spirit, stop doing all of the working. There's always tons of work to do, laundry and sweeping up and cleaning, and the kids are all expected to do that here. So it gives them a chance to stop, and they put their minds together in unity and a moment of calm and stillness, like that. And then the giving of the food, that actually goes back, most of that food, like 90% of it or 95% of it, goes back round. It fills up a bag that the kids who are with me are carrying, and then they take it back to their home, and there's one house that's very good at dividing up that and sharing it around. So, and then I end up with a few bits in the bowl at the end of it.
I first met him by the shore, and I really see that he is a very good brother. He's kind-hearted. We met two times on the shore, and I told him, I am walking here because I am exercising, getting the benefit from the sun, because I am ill. I got sick, very sick that time. And I even told him the second time that we met, I am bitten by a dog. Oh, he told me. And one time he passed by here. I called him, "My brother, this is my house, this is my house." I never knew that he was going to my brother. That's all. And first of all, I was ashamed to invite him here because my house is not good. But when I invited him inside, he's a very, what is that, good person, that whatever I give him a small drink, coffee, he takes it. That made us very good brothers and sisters. It all started, and he he came to see my grandson. What can I do for your grandson? He asked her. And so he was very much ready to help. He did everything to help me. And I had not even asked you to help me. It was you first who offered your help. So I really admired him because I have also known that he is also, later I have known that he is also helping other people around. He's a very kind man, ready to help.
He said, my sister has a grandson and he needs an operation. So I introduced myself and asked, what are we looking at? What kind of money and what's the need and what's the urgency? And he has a disease of the colon called Hirschsprung disease. And that means that when they're born, they quickly realize that they cannot expel feces normally. So they have to make a colostomy bag on the side of the stomach, so the food is then expelled to the bag, and it has to be changed and changed and changed. But there is an operation where you can take out that part of the colon and then reconnect it, and so that it all works properly. And so there was a opportunity where I was able to photograph on and put on Facebook about that in a short paragraph, that this case was there, and if anyone wanted to help, they could contact me. So a very old associate from my school days wrote to me, by surprise to me, and said they would fund the cost of the operation or the transport and things around them. And it both Fern and another family had been told more or less the same thing, that you had to go to do this operation, you had to fly and stay in Manila, and it was a highly expensive operation, around about 230,000 pesos all in all, when you added everything all up. So I went on just Google and just put colostomy Palawan in. So I just pressed one and immediately came up a free medical mission that had been here before on a Coron Island, and they were based in Philadelphia, and it was a Filipino man and his wife who had trained and practiced in America, specializing in that disease operation, and they were coming here with equipment and medical to give their knowledge and their skills for free, called Dr. Alviar, Domingo Alviar. And when I looked, the actual date was almost that they were about to arrive this year was like 2 days away. So I was rushing to find where they were going to be and when they were going to be, and also to try to connect with the other family who had come forward and said they got another child with the same disease and the same need for treatment, operation. So actually at that time it was very difficult to get the information, and it was a new situation for all of us. And money, how to get money transferred rapidly, how to find where they were going to be, and I contacted the office in Philadelphia. They had already left, they didn't have mobile phones, the person there didn't know the geography of the Philippines. I was asking, where's this city, and they didn't know, or which island, they don't know, and many, many difficult things. So eventually, actually, what happened, to cut a long story short, which was a very complex one, put it that way, was the other family successfully went to Bacolod, Negros, and then they had the full operation, very similar, and came back, and we'll visit them a little later on. And in this case, it's the next year's one. It wasn't possible to connect them. Absolutely. So this is the house of Jenny and Sergio. When I first met her, she was taking care of a baby who had Down syndrome, two holes in the heart, and also had pneumonia as a consequence. So, and the mother had some sort of a mental instability or weakness that she was having difficult coping. So Jenny had to stop her studies to take care of the little baby. And there were two other kids as well. So I was looking at how you could help, and I offered and paid for home help to come in to take care of a lot of the basic necessities so that she could be relieved of some of the stress. During this whole next period, the baby actually died just of pneumonia, which is very common. It's one of the highest killers here in Palawan. And So that difficulty, including the funeral cost and everything, came into it. I introduced a guest who said he would sponsor her, Jenny, to get back into studying again, so that she would be able to break the cycle by getting employment, getting income, and then be able to bring that back into the home. Because the dad was like away all the time. He was he pretty much faded away from the scene. So the rest of them were left struggling. So that was the situation. It's this gap between what the family can do for their own support and what the government will provide. You know, there's kind of often a gap in between. No matter what they're supposed to happen, it often doesn't, or it's just complicated. There's this gap where humans can hear about it and humans can jump in. So it's humanitarian sort of aid like that. So now she's going to start a business course in 3 months. She's considering it. Actually, her switch, she said, I want to now do nursing rather than business, having seen what her sister went through and dying, and the hospital work and care work. So there's a 3-month gap between all those courses will start. So we've bought a laptop and we're helping her learn computer skills and becoming one of the team who will learn to fundraise for her own family, and then also hopefully extend it out for the other cases who can't get to the office or don't, you know, too old or too young to learn to do that kind of thing. I wanted to introduce you also to Dindin. She has experience in reporting and in news, having a news website, and is experienced somewhat in also fundraising. She can encourage you, you know, explain, having had, she's seen successful in doing it, and she can explain her experience and so on. In Tagalog as well. Not always in English, like you're always having to listen to my difficult English. I went away to Australia, Singapore, Malaysia, Thailand, with the view to earn money to come back and buy a house, and even to raise a family. That was really what I was thinking, to build a house and raise a family. And I went to Sydney and I earned good money, and I went to Singapore, it wasn't so easy. I went to Malaysia, and then I went to Thailand. And my view was then, my plan had been to go into Hong Kong, last stop, and then come back with all of my bag of savings and buy a land and a house and build and start to live like that. And most of that went well. I invited a girlfriend of mine who I'd wanted, you know, I thought about as a possible partner, to Singapore, and we met there, and we traveled through Malaysia together, and it didn't go so well. It was rocky, it wasn't so good, and many, many things about it got unhappy and complaining and all that, both of us. And so I preferred the solo life before. When we got to Thailand, it was by Chiang Mai or so on, it was very stressed, and we weren't both of us very happy. We went into a meditation center, and I really found myself there. I suddenly realized I was much happier there in that lifestyle, and also learning to meditate, and also working with people. I had been training to draw and illustrate, and that's quite a lonely life actually. But working with people and talking about their emotions, about their spiritual life, I suddenly found I'm completely at home here. And then I asked, can I come and stay here? They said, sure, why don't you think about becoming a monk? You're really suited, you know, we're all saying so, you seem really at home. And I was like, please, I'd love to. And it wasn't like a difficult university to enter, or that you have got this quality. They were very welcoming, and they made it easy for me to enter. So I went back to my parents in England, I took my girlfriend home, we separated, I told my friends what I'm thinking to do, and it was a big change. So my parents said, yeah, you have our blessing, you do what makes you happy. And then I went back, and I fully ordained, and then I stayed there for 2.5 years, training as a teacher's assistant, and then becoming a teacher's assistant, and then learning all the monks' rules, and caring for about 20 Westerners who are learning to meditate a day, and then reporting them on their interview or their meditation experience. So it's like several thousand interviews I sat through to learn that basic. And then at the end of that, I also still had doubts about my life. I'm young, I still could do things, you know. So I left and then explored all that over the next 20 plus years, and then went to the places I'd never been to and did the things I'd never done, and, you know, like got my successes I want to succeed in, and then I decided to come back as a monk again.
Yeah. How old were you that time?
I was 22, and then that was when I was in the Philippines, and then
I traveled for like a year, and then I ordained, and that, by that then I was 25 until I was 28. I think that was a, I think it's about.
How did you land in the Philippines the second time?
It's not actually second time, it's more like third time, but I had returned to, in 2009 I returned to my original training monastery and I told them I'm not staying, but I'd like to revisit. I went to Malaysia, on to Sri Lanka, to Burma, to Malaysia and back to Burma, and I kind of decided Burma was the place I was going to stay at. And then I noticed on Facebook groups were popping up called meditation in the Philippines, Buddhism in the Philippines, Dharma group of Manila, and all these. I thought that's pretty interesting. That's kind of weird. I never put the two things together, but Buddhist training, Dharma and Vipassana and these things, and the Philippines. I'd always sort of thought Philippines is just totally Christian and Catholic and not interested, and there's nothing there for on that type of thing. So then a group wrote to me and they made friends on one of those groups and they said, we like some of your postings and we're also looking for a teacher who can do a retreat and visiting lecturers and visiting teachers like that. I said I'm extremely interested and I've been here before in 1984, and they said, oh, well that's a great plus and we're looking for someone. Would you come and do an 8 or 9 day retreat in Manila, in Laguna, Calamba Laguna? So I agreed and we came, they hosted me, and then all the thing was to fly back again, but you know, I said, well, I'd be happy to stay on. They said, we'll be happy to provide, you know, your support for doing that and encouragement. So I stayed there then in Laguna for 3 months, and then at the end of the 3 months the main sponsor said, well, there's a place called Palawan and there's a retreat center there that we've spoken to them, they would be happy to host you. So then that's how I came to Palawan. And since then I've sort of grown out of that center to build my own temple residence, which is more in line with the Buddhist monk style living. Yeah. So that's pretty much how I, the main two times. I did, there was another time after I disrobed, I went to Japan and then I went to the Philippines to revisit it. There was another short visit in there as well.
So you've been around Filipino people a long time.
Quite.
And I'm sure you've grown to become like, they become beloved to you.
Yeah.
How and why are they different or the same from other people, and why are they so close to your heart?
Southeast Asian people, so the people in Thailand, the people in Sri Lanka, and the people in Malaysia, and also Latino people. I visited Cuba, for example. Often you really love those people, but you can't communicate so well. Now, both the attitude of the Filipinos, they're very warm and accepting and befriending. That's one thing. But then there's the language as well. Now, much as I'm trying to learn Tagalog and I want to be able to become fluent in the end, already you can start to speak and share a lot. Now, you can't do that in Sri Lanka, you can't do that in Thailand, you can't do that in Burma. Your average village people, one of them will have learned some English, but it's a bit of a rarity. The most homegrown people, farmers and fishermen and people around, don't really do it, you know. And they have a script. It's a difficult language to read. Mm. You can't. It's like Chinese or something, or Japanese. It's got a script, or Vietnamese. So here, you basically, what you see is what you get, you know. If it says Maligayang, you can speak, you can read that, you know, like that. And but most of the ordinary people, you can just have a talk with. You can discuss things easily. So the two things makes it very, and but it's also the warmth of the people there, very befriending and easy. The kids will just come, hi, how you doing, hey, good morning, hey, and sir, they're respectful as well, they're nice, you know, they're very pleasant. All of these qualities, they're not materialistic, scientific, educated people, developed. That colds people, it makes them very segregated and individualistic, and here, the warmth of the family unity, the village structure, the trust among people, and they're very codependent, they're used to sharing everything, you know. It's very, very, all those are qualities that have gone weaker and weaker and weaker in Western societies that have become more developed and materialistic and educated. As people become more separated, segregated, isolated, self-centered, dependent on themselves, you know, and all the things, the way that they readily, easily call me brother here, or father, easy. Hey, brother Ben. They want to call me that, and they just can accept me in like it's all accepting and all including, easily like that. And it's different that Western culture is more like everyone's getting left out, everyone's leaving each other out, and that's the big thing, is everyone's super independent, you know. And the more middle class gets bigger, then everyone's mm-hmm. you know, like ambitious and expected to show, you know, oh, we're having our second holiday, hey, we've got two cars, we've got, you know, like a house, everyone, all the kids have got their own big room, it's a big room, and it's, you know, mm-hmm. but here people just share and mix much more.
Yeah.
So those qualities are spiritual qualities as well.
Mm.
So more people are more humble, you know, it's not everywhere. I find it a lot here in the barangay and in the people who are still quite close to their roots. And the rhythm of life, it's slower here, whereas when people start going towards time and money, and time is space, and space is time, and time is money, they speed up, and then they get out of natural rhythm.
Is it something like part of your training, or...?
No, I mean, in our main school, you're not encouraged to do too much welfare work, you're more encouraged to do meditation and purify your own mind and work on yourself. Like that. I'm more attracted. I come from a Catholic background with Methodist mum and auntie, great aunties and everything, and Baptist. And they're a bit more, you know, a bit more welfare work, their spirituality. They're, and I've seen some Buddhists doing that, more humanitarian, more welfare work. And that inspired me. I saw it where there's a Taiwanese organization who help in the tsunami. They fly to Pakistan to help people. They're doing a lot more hospital type work. And I was liking that. I was saying, I like that, but I don't want to leave my order totally. I wonder if I can kind of blend it in. So in going round here, people presented me with, you know, clear problems where I could help. Or even just the idea of Facebook, just saying, look, if anyone wants to help, there's this situation. And they did. So I was like pretty impressed, you know, that how that happened. And then I just decided, well, that was pretty easy for me. Why not? Let's just keep going and see what happens. So it's it also has brought quite a lot of energy to my meditation that was lacking, that I was getting a bit soggy, a bit sort of low, a bit, you know. But when you get that energy to help other people, and the challenges, and understand how to do it, it gives you an activity to do as well.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, that's been a really rewarding experience. You know, I've worked before in the West with cerebral palsy kids or something like that, or charity work, and for me it's never got quite the way that I was happy with from my side. This I'm much happier with, you know, that I'm also able to do it with autonomously on my own grounds, you know, own choice. I'm not working for a big company like one of these massive companies. It's small, it's person to person, and you can really see results very quick, and that's also pretty good.
Do you have any questions?
The experience of meeting the child who couldn't naturally go to the toilet, that was a big experience, and it was a big challenge. That wasn't such an easy one. Some of them quite easy. This person wants to give, they go and buy school uniforms, there it is, you know, and everyone's happy. That's kind of quite easy. So again, there's like gradual layers, you know, gradual complexities, and that one was a much bigger challenge. I like a challenge. I like to use all my skills all together. And that one was complex, that was difficult. I had to research, I had to learn, it's a completely new thing. It also makes you appreciate what you've got. There's something that's naturally a reward that comes back. When you realize that you were bought shoes and you never thought about it, you never really considered it. Or that your home country has a welfare state that you just naturally can go to hospital for free, you don't really even think about it. So people start to sort of take that for granted. So if you get back the sense of gratitude that you've lost, because many Westerners, I think they just get spoiled. It's like if you give children too much sugar, they end up just miserable. You think sugar makes people happy. Well, it's the same when you give people too much things for free, they lose the sense of gratitude. Whereas here, you know, you really see that the children and the families are actually saying thank you. They're not saying, I expected you to do more than that. Well, you know, like something like this when people are spoiled. Cancer cases, poverty cases. We don't see too much poverty, visible poverty. That's something else. When you realize that someone doesn't have food in the house, you don't really think of that in the West because it doesn't really happen so much, so you never see it too much. Or where someone really doesn't have somewhere to sleep tonight, you know, and they're sleeping on a bench, they have to because they just don't have somewhere. And here you can actually buy a house. You got 4,000 pesos and a carpenter who's willing to help out. You can make a mini bahay kubo. That's enough. That person's now got a little place to stay in. That's pretty refreshing. You know, we get sort of swamped in the complexities in the West. Too much complications. And even the law preventing you from doing it, or insurance companies or something like this, you know. But here you can, your natural kindness. You want to help that guy? Not much to stop you. He's not going to sue you. It's not a trick. You know, generally these are much more human. You can, and it's the humanness. Mostly nowadays we've come where technology wins. The answer is scientific management. And here it's more peopleness. It's the peopleness that works. And that gives us back it, what we've lost a bit in the West. So that's the natural reward. So I'm trying to think of actual examples. It's difficult. It's a bit difficult to pull them right out. You know, someone with a broken hearing aid, and all they hear is when they put it on, and they're lonely. So you don't realize that deaf people get so lonely. You think, yeah, of course, because we're talking all the time. So it connects us. You get them a battery. It took a little while to find that battery as well. It had to be flown or posted from Manila, and then we put the battery in. She's like, hey. She's got a well back. Or I think one of the most touching ones, that for just emotionally, was offering to attend the graduation ceremony. This girl who's on it. That's a difficult, messy family. They don't have much hope. And she goes to a Saturday school only. She's a single mum, got pregnant young. And she said, will you attend my graduation ceremony? I was like, yeah, I don't know. Yeah, okay. I don't know what it's about, but I'll go. Yeah, why not? So I went, and it was a 6-hour ceremony, 12 until 6. All the whole school sitting there, like, I have to watch it. I happened to arrive on my tricycle just at the right time. They pretty much said, here's the seat. And then she came up on the stage and sort of like got it, and there was someone there to see it. And there wouldn't have been. There'd been no one, you know. Her parents hadn't gone, or her mum, the dads don't know where, but the mum would have been too busy. So no one would have seen her get that. Now, there's other people in the barangay who told me about that happened to them. No one was at their graduation ceremony. So how'd you feel? You know, you feel terrible. So I felt very touched by that, you know, and that was very moving for me to suddenly realize. And I put it on Facebook, said, hey, I kind of make someone's day. You know, there's nothing like it if you can do that. And people wrote back, they said, you know, she'll remember that for the rest of her life.
And you're part of her life and the community.
And it was such an easy thing to do. All I had to say was yes. That's half of it, is, you know, most people go, no, I don't know, like, I don't know if I really want to give that away. No, no, you know, people hold back. But when there's a lot of faith, there's a lot of trusting involved in it, and people are closer to that here. There's much more faith and trust flowing and depending on each other. You know, they let the kids run around, they don't really paranoid, they don't lock everyone away, people don't lock themselves away just in case. And people are depending much more on each other here. In between, and there's not that shame of being needing. To hear people aren't afraid to say, I need some money, can you help us out? We really don't have any money. People in the West are very suspicious of that, because everyone's got enough money. That's why they're suspicious, you know, because they think, well, everyone can, we did, it was easy, so you should be able to. But here, generally, a lot of the people really do need money. Money can be a medicine, and we've become very suspicious of money in the West. But it really can act directly help someone if you give 500 pesos or something. Goes, oh, thanks so much. God, and now we've got some milk to give the baby, and it won't get pneumonia or whatever it is. Yeah. It's big.
Just as river full of water fill the ocean full. Tulad ng isang ilog na puno ng tubig upang punan ang buong karagatan. Even so, those that heard given benefits to dead, the hungry spirits. Kahit na ang ginagawa na ito ay bumibigay pakinabangan sa mga yumao, ang gutom na espiritu. May whatever you wish or want quickly come to be. Maaring ang anumang iyong kahilingan at ninanais ay pumasa iyo ng mabilis. May all your aspirations be fulfilled. Maaring ang lahat ng iyong mga hinahangad ay matutupad. As the moon on the 15th full moon day, or as a radiant bright gem, bilang ang buwan sa 15 araw, o bilang isang nagliliwanag, maliwanag na perlas. May all distresses be averted. Maaring lahat ng kabalisaan ay lumayo. May every disease be destroyed. Maaring bawat sakit ay mapuksa. May there be no dangers for you. Maaaring mayroong walang panganib para sa iyo. May you be happy and long and live long. Maaari kang maging masaya at mabuhay ng mahaba. For one of respectful nature who constantly honored the worthy, para sa isa sa kagalang-galang na kalikasan na patuloy na parangalan ang kapakinabangan. Four qualities increase. Ang apat na kalidad ay tataas. Long life, mahabang buhay, beauty, kagandahan, happiness, kasiyahan, strength, lakas.